Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Welcome to the MS... I already screwed it up. It's the MS Research Visiting Speaker Series. My name's Stefan Weitz. I previously worked over in Bing. I now work over in education, trying to figure out how we can get Microsoft in the education game more effectively. But today it's not about me, as much as I like to think it is always about me. Today, Ben Parr is here, a buddy of mine for years, to talk about his new book, Captivology. I met Ben probably 4 or 5 years ago now. He was, at the time, just a little blogger sitting in a beanbag at a conference. And he was working on some crappy old machine, and he was still running, if I recall correctly, I think Windows XP, or maybe it was Mac, I can't think of which. But anyway, I happen to have a copy of Windows 7 in my bag, as I always do, as you should always do as well, as you travel around the world. Always have free software. It was a Dell? I said it was a Dell, that's right. And I said, look, upgrade right now. And he said he would, if he only had a DVD of Windows 7, which I then produced for him and said, here you go, now upgrade now. So we got Ben up on Windows 7 back in the day, in situ at a conference upgrade. But today is about his book, which is fascinating, because if we all know in this room that the average human being is exposed to about 7 DVDs worth of information every single day, staggering amounts of information and content. The challenge we all have is to figure out how we sift through all that to make sense and to find that signal through the noise. And it's not just about our ability to sift through it. It's about the content producer's abilities to articulate a message in a particular way, in a way that will, in essence, captivate us. Something is vibrating up here. I apologize. Oh, it's Ben's phone. For content producers and production houses to speak in a way that makes us want to pay attention. And so the book you're going to hear about today is a fascinating book that actually shows, I think, 7 steps or 7 different ways that we can all in this room, from getting your kids to go to bed at night to pitching Satya on the next big idea you might have, how you can both capture, retain, and maximize the attention of others as you go about your daily life. So with that, I'll introduce Ben Parr. Come on down, Ben.
That's such a lovely introduction. I forgot about you giving me Windows 7. That was the first time.
I think it was.
I need those new surfaces. Hello, everybody. I've been told so much about it by some of you. Hi, everybody. My name is Ben Parr. And after that lovely introduction, I feel like I don't have to say a damn thing about me. So I'm just going to get started. And at the end of this, I'm going to open it up, obviously, to Q&A, and I want you all to think about what kind of questions you want to ask and the kind of things that you want to learn, especially when it comes to capturing attention for your products, your ideas, your companies, or just, you know, the science of attention and how it works and how it works in the human mind. And so, as he said, I spent over 2 years doing this research for Captivology, culminating in this. But let me start off with a video.
Hi there. My name is Doug. Yeah. My master made me this collar so that I may talk. Squirrel! Hi there.
So, I feel like Doug the dog from Up, screaming squirrel every 15 to 20 seconds. And I'm sure a lot of you feel the same way. And what's happening is we have entered a completely new era of attention. You know, and there was one study that found in 1986, approximately, we were exposed to approximately what? 46 newspapers worth of information. In 2006, that number increased to 176. And now we're getting to DVDs and DVDs worth of information. And nearly 90% of the world's information has been created in the last 3 years. And when you have so much information being created and so much information being exposed, it can be hard to have your ideas, to have your products, to have anything else rise to the surface. This is my actual tweet deck. I took a screenshot. I'm pretty sure that my attention is screwed for life with something like that. And a lot of you probably have something similar. Even worse is the multitasking, which I'm sure, like, you know, Linda Stone, who used to work here, will tell you that multitasking is actually hurting us in terms of our productivity. One study found that those who identify as heavy multimedia multitaskers are the least effective when it comes to completing and switching between tasks. When you switch between tasks, when you get interrupted, it can take up to 14 minutes to get back on track. And these habits, which we have taken on as a necessity in the world of technological, social media attention has had this down effect. So given all that, how do you capture attention for your ideas, for your products, for your passions, whatever they may be? And how do you stand out? And more, and just as important, how do you defend your attention? How do you keep your attention focused when you need it to be? And so those are the kind of subjects I discuss in Captivology. And I'm going to give you a little bit of a rundown of some of the things that I talk about more specifically, the three stages of attention in my model of attention, and the seven captivation triggers. And these are seven psychological triggers that I found that capture attention across these three stages, regardless of culture, regardless of industry, regardless of what you do. They're fundamental to human nature. And combined, when you do that, they create what I call the bonfire of attention. Is in my model, I kind of say like the spark, and I should have brought like matches or something, but I think I would have burned something down here. But the spark is immediate attention, which is the first stage of attention. Immediate attention is our immediate reaction to things. It's, you know, when someone like takes a gun in there and goes bang. Usually, I actually have a confetti cannon for this, and I'm out of confetti cannons. I'm sorry. But it's immediate attention. It's an immediate automatic reaction to certain sights, sounds, and colors. It's a defense mechanism that we have. Imagine if we had to think about whether or not we needed to react when a car was going right at us. We'd be a dead human species. In the second stage, short attention, what I call the kindling of attention, it's our conscious short-term focus on a certain thing, whether it's a song, a TV show, a movie, a speaker, whatever that may be. It's when we consciously focus on something. But in my model, the most important form of attention is the third stage, which is long attention, which is our long-term interest in something. It is how we, it is our long-term fascination with something. So let me tell you a little bit about each of the stages. So the first stage, like I've already told you, is that immediate reaction, is that visceral reaction. And it's controlled by something called sensory memory, which is something that lasts for fractions of a second that helps us remember immediate sights, sounds, and colors. In short attention, it's all about that focus, whether that's school test or that book or whatever it might be. Or, you know, that goddamn dress. I'm surprised I haven't run into anyone wearing the dress yet. Maybe that's what I need to do. That's a terrible idea. Actually, that's a great idea. I'm going to do that. You just saw the end to the idea. It's going to be scary. The short attention, though, is a fascinating mechanism. It's controlled by a system called working memory. And I don't have too much time to go through working memory, but essentially, it is the temporary storage, the short-term memory system that controls information, especially auditory and visual, and kind of takes long-term memory and finds context within it. And it is a very complicated system, but suffice it to say, it is the way in which we pay attention in the short term. Long attention, on the other hand, is really about that long-term interest in long attention. It's the reason, it's the difference between listening to a Beyoncé song and becoming a lifelong fan of Beyoncé. It's the reason why someone like a Beyoncé can just drop an album and suddenly everyone will buy and she'll go platinum. I found out that, you know, Lady Gaga's last two albums, which did really well, didn't even come close to Beyoncé's, which had no marketing at all. And it's because of that relationship built over years and that community she's built. And I'll describe that a little bit later in the book, in the presentation. So those are your three stages that create the bonfire of attention. Now let's get into the fun meat of it all, the captivation triggers. And these are the seven psychological triggers that capture attention across all stages. Trigger number one, automaticity. If you're a hitchhiker on the side of the road and you want to have the best chance of being picked up, what color shirt do you think you should wear? Someone, guess.
Blue.
I've heard every color so far.
Nothing?
Nothing? If you want a streak, go ahead. I was thinking wearing blue and black or white and gold. You know, that might be good. The answer is actually, it's a little bit gender specific. So if you're a man, most bright colors will work. Yellows, greens, yellows and reds and oranges because of the gray background and the, you know, gray roads, black roads, green grass, that sort of thing. If you're a woman, there was actually a study that was done over in France, and this researcher had women wear different colored shirts to see which one would be picked up most of the time. Most of the time, the average was around 13%. Darker colors performed worse, except for the color red. 21% of the time, they got picked up. And the reason is actually because of the subconscious romantic associations we have with the color red. In fact, if you put a thick red border around a person's face, the opposite gender will rate that person as more attractive. That's why, you know. I just like this picture. I like excuses for putting this picture in. But there's all these kind of crazy subconscious associations. In fact, part of the reason why my book has the blue and teal border is because blue is highly has the highest correlation with competence. Immediate attention is an automatic response, and so that's the big thing to remember. With sights, sounds, colors, we have two reactions to certain every sensory input. I call them contrast and association. Contrast is the contrast of which a sound or a sensory stimuli is with the environment. It's the reason why I'll show you in a moment why yellows and oranges work very well on buying websites because they have the high contrast with whites and gray backgrounds of websites. The other thing was association. Association, on the other hand, is about the subconscious associations we have with certain colors or symbols or sounds or things like that. So, as I said before, yellow and orange are great for capturing attention for clicking buttons, but they're actually terrible for if you want people to take you seriously. So what do you think when you see this person wearing an orange suit? What do you think? Any words? Pick words. Say words. Word association game.
Clown.
Clown. That's a good one. Actually, usually I hear Dutch is the first thing. It is. I've done this once or twice, and I'm like, OK. But orange is actually has the lowest correlation with competence, orange and yellow. And so think about it. If a guy in an orange suit or a gal in an orange suit walked into your office for a job interview, you'd laugh your ass off. But there's a reason for that, and the reason why certain of these colors really matter. And you know, I go through a lot of these fascinating color correlations and symbol correlations and sound correlations. And in fact, you know, also the cultural correlations, because while, for example, green may mean more nature in the US, green's terrible packaging in China because green has more associations with death. And even smells matter. This is the camellia flower. Revlon did a perfume out of this flower, and it did pretty well in the U.S. So, like, we're just going to go international. Let's put it in South America. The problem, though, with that is that this flower is associated with funerals. And so it was literally, we want you to smell like a funeral. That did not turn out well. And this is why you have to really think about color associations and associations and automaticity and the kind of automatic reactions people have to whichever stimuli you put in front of them. Trigger number two. Framing. To tell about framing, I have to tell you a story about deodorant. I made a mess. So in the 1910s, there was no deodorants. There was no deodorant or antiperspirants. In fact, this is the stuff that people literally use to smell better. Dress shields and cotton pads. And there were two reasons why they didn't use deodorants and antiperspirants. The first reason is because people thought it was unhealthy or could kill you to wear an antiperspirant, which it does not kill you. And the second thing, and the more important factor, was this frame of reference where people would not discuss anything related to body odors. It was a Victorian era kind of thing. It was uncouth to talk about bodily fluids of any kind. It was not ladylike. So in the 1910s, there was this gal, teenager named Edna Murphy. Her father, a surgeon, invented an antiperspirant for his hand so that he didn't sweat while doing surgeries. This entrepreneur was thoughtfully like, you know what? I could put that in my armpits. So she did, and it turned into this product, Odor Oh No. I love the name. Exactly. She got a $500 investment from her grandfather and started this business and started doing well, you know? Like, she started pushing it, but she kept on hitting this barrier of getting more people to use it because of the things I just told you about health concerns and the people not willing to talk about body odor. So she teamed up with a copywriter, James Webb Young, who eventually became the first chairman of the Ad Council, to go and address these issues. So they decided, we got to address these frames of reference. First frame of reference, how do we get people to realize you won't die by using Odor Oh No? Well, a surgeon invented it, so they advertised that fact hard. And sales doubled the next year after they did that. But the more important thing was, how do you get people to actually talk about deodorant? So they had tackled that one head on. This is the actual ad from 1919 in the most popular magazine of the time, Ladies Home Journal, of course, talking about how we're going to have a frank discussion of a subject too often avoided. This ad was the most controversial thing of the year. Hundreds of women canceled their Ladies Home Journal subscription because of that. But it worked. It worked. So sales doubled from 400,000 to well over a million the next year. And a couple years later, Edna Murphy sold her company and made millions. Because suddenly it was okay to start talking about deodorants and antiperspirants. And suddenly other people started advertising that fact. And the industry grew until, you know, now it's an $81 billion industry. Odorono, by the way. So you must adapt to your audience frame of reference, like Edna Murphy did, figuring out what is their frame of reference, what is their worldview. Frame of reference is how we view something. It's the reason why you talk about global warming and two people have two completely different reactions to it. It's how we grow up. It's also our biology. Odorono, in this case, was able to adapt to their frame of reference by talking about how it was made by a doctor, and they reframed the conversation by making it okay to talk about. I'm going to talk about another kind of frame of reference, scarcity. So who likes Twinkies? Nobody. You are a smart group. I hate Twinkies. People actually raise their hands, and then I have to scold them. Twinkies are disgusting. They are the bane of existence. They taste like crap. But you all remember a few years ago when Hostess went bankrupt, right? And suddenly everyone went to go buy Twinkies. And it wasn't because anything changed about Twinkies. They did not get any tastier. They did not taste any less like shit. And yet people went to buy because of this frame of reference. Because suddenly it was scarce. And the research shows that when people feel like something is scarce, especially when it's scarce because of outside forces, its value that people place on it goes much higher. It's the same reason why, for example, in years ago, and I'm sorry I'm going to talk about a competitor's product, Gmail had the invite system, and people were willing to pay, like someone offered me $100 to buy a Gmail invite. And I'm like, how does it make effing sense? Here's your Gmail invite, by the way. But that kind of scarcity effect really does work because it really changes the frame of reference in which people view something. Trigger number three, disruption. We pay attention to the things that violate our expectations. And so there was a study that was done a few years ago, and what they did was they gave subjects different kind of lines to see which ones would be more memorable. And they would have like sentences like, the maid cooked a meal, versus the maid licked the ammonia off the floor. Which one do you think people remembered better? And there's actually a term for this, the bizarreness effect. And part of the reason why we have this greater memory for and pay more attention to things that violate our expectations is because it's a defense mechanism. So he's sleeping. Let's pretend we're on a date.
Okay.
All right. Let's pretend we're sitting on a date, and suddenly a parade of clowns comes and sits down right next to us. We're going to pay attention to them, right? But the reason why is because we are automatically making a threat assessment. It's called expectancy violations theory. We are trying to immediately figure out, is this thing a threat or is this thing a positive element? Maybe this is our good friends who are about to visit a hospital, or maybe this is a group of clown muggers that are about to take all our money. We don't know, but we make the automatic assessment. It's what we did when we were hunter-gatherers. We're like, is that rustle in the bushes food or trying to eat us? And there are effective ways to use this disruption trigger, as I call it, to capture attention. This is a couple years ago, the Patagonia campaign, don't buy this jacket. This is a clothing brand telling you not to buy their clothes. Makes no sense at all, right? But when you go into the thing deeper, you find out that what they're trying to do is say, we don't want you to buy our stuff unnecessarily. If we could repair it, we'll repair it for you. If you want us to help you, we want to help the environment because it takes up a lot of water to use to make one of these jackets. But we'll sell you one if you want one. And this message of don't buy our stuff made people buy more of their stuff. Sales doubled within the first 3 months and kept on going up and have been higher much ever since. Old Spice guy, another great example of the disruption trigger. Every 3 to 5 seconds is something crazy is happening, but it's always a very kind of positive element, something fun, you know? Diamonds or people swimming in pools or unicorns or horses, all things you want to do. At least I like diamonds and horses and unicorns. So the disruption trigger is a really powerful effect. But a lot of people use the disruption trigger incorrectly. Because the disruption trigger must match your brand's values. I call this significance. And the issue sometimes is people use the disruption trigger for shock advertising to get people to just to pay attention by pure shock. And that doesn't always work. And in fact, there is a difference between positive attention and negative attention. That's a very key point to really remember. A couple years ago, there was this ad by Quiznos. They had these weird fucking looking rodent things talking about eating sandwiches. Who would want to eat a sandwich that had these things next to it? These things look like mutated mice. No fucking sense. And of course, you know, proving my point, Quiznos went bankrupt last year. There is such a thing as good attention versus bad attention. It must match your values. Trigger number four, reward. So there was another study, I'm gonna talk about mice again. There was a study done by Dr. Kent Barrage of the University of Michigan, who I interviewed for the book. And what he did was he took the dopamine out of laboratory mice. Now, everybody has this association of dopamine as pleasure, but that's actually not true. What he found was that the mice still felt pleasure when the dopamine was out of their systems. If you gave it sugar water, it would still find it tasty. But what he found was that when the dopamine was out of these mice, they lost motivation. They were demotivated from achieving any rewards. And in fact, most of them died because they were so demotivated they'd rather starve to death than try to eat. And so what dopamine does is actually create motivation to achieve a reward, to achieve pleasure. It creates wanting. And it's opioids that actually create liking. And your job as to capture attention is actually activate the wanting response. And that's what's really important with the reward trigger. There are two types of rewards. There's intrinsic rewards and extrinsic rewards. Extrinsic rewards are the very, very kind of, you know, physical things, food, money, sex, and that do capture attention. In fact, there was a study that found that if you associate an object with money, even just a few cents, people's eyes will track towards that object more often, even after that object is no longer associated with money. Attention automatically shifts for extrinsic rewards. But that doesn't capture attention over the long term. That's a great tool. Extrinsic rewards are great for capturing short attention. Long attention, on the other hand, is better with intrinsic rewards. Rewards like purpose and mastery and self-satisfaction. And it's that combination that captures attention across all three stages. So you must create motivation in order to capture attention. But there's a couple ways to help boost that up. A couple years ago, there was a company called Scopely, and they wanted to hire more engineers. They're like, how do we create rewards to get more engineers to come? You know, everyone offers money for, you know, bounties for people coming in. So what they did was they parodied the Most Interesting Man in the World campaign. And they're like, if you sign up for us, not only are we going to give you $11,000, but we're going to wrap it in bacon. Literally, they wrapped it in bacon, in cash. And not just that, but you got an oil painting of yourself, Macallan 15, and a harpoon gun. I personally want the harpoon gun. I want to feel what that feels like. They got over 1,000 applications just by doing this. Surprising rewards capture attention much more than any other type of rewards. I had another study that found that if they did, they would spray water or citrus into a person's mouth. And they found that when people couldn't predict when it would be water or citrus, when they didn't know the pattern, people felt much more pleasure and surprise and had greater memory of the task. And so creating surprising rewards is really powerful impact, whether it's the reward itself is surprising or you surprise people with the reward. Which actually brings me to my next point. And I apologize that I have iPhones up here instead of Microsoft phones instead of Windows phones. I could not find Windows phones versions of this. But this is Keep. And it is a platform for delivering rewards. And what they do is when you have an achievement in a game or an achievement in an app like a Nike app, you suddenly get this message saying, like, you have earned a reward. And you didn't know it was coming. And it might be something like a Gatorade or extra points or something like that. And what they found, this is called post-action rewards. And these types of rewards capture a lot more attention and make people feel happier and create longer retention than your standard type, incentives. Incentives are the worst type or the least effective type of rewards. Rather than you being like, you do this, I'll give you this, it's much better to surprise somebody with a reward after the fact for taking an action that you want them to take. Post-action rewards. Again, the surprise really matters. Trigger number five, you've been good. We have three more. Ooh, actually, this is fun. Trigger number five. Now I'm ready. Reputation. You may be wondering why I put on a laboratory coat. I'm about to answer that. There was a study done at Emory University where they were looking at fMRIs of students while they made economic decisions. You know, they were making decisions about how to spend their money. And, you know, when you have that, the decision-making centers of the brain start kind of lighting up, as you can imagine, right? And that's what they found. But in half the case studies, they had an expert come in to give the students advice on what to do with the money. And it was an economics professor saying, like, take the conservative route with this money that you've been given. And what they found actually was that, and these are the real screen, these are the real like scans. They found that the ones that were listening to the experts, the decision-making brain centers of their brains pretty much shut down. It was as if they offloaded the processing power of their brains to the experts. And so this is a subject, this is a phenomenon known as directed deference from Robert Cialdini's book. And what essentially is the point is that we pay huge amounts of attention to reputable sources and we pay extra attention to experts. And there's a couple reasons. One is because of the associations we have with them. Actually, if you just put on a, if you tell someone they have, you put a doctor's coat on them and you tell them it's a doctor's coat, their attention will, on average, be sharper and they will have less mistakes and they will complete tasks better, purely by the association that a doctor's coat has with attention. If you have the same coat and you tell them it's a painter's coat, people's attention actually goes down. And there's another effect to this as well. It's that we trust experts more than anybody else. And so this is the Edelman Trust Survey. They do a survey every year what type of people, spokespeople they people trust. And every year, consistently at the top, academics are experts. Much higher than people like you or analysts or CEOs and government regulators are somewhere in the basement. But this combination is why they capture so much attention. And so there's three types of what I call reputable sources. Experts being the most powerful, the authority figures because of the authority they have over us, and the crowd, because the crowd itself is actually an expert, especially when it comes to things like collective decision making. Yelp is a very powerful expert in which food you should eat because we trust the crowd's judgment in general. And so your key with capturing attention is to leverage experts and establish credibility. Now, Odor Ono did this, for example, by advertising the fact that it was created by a doctor. And smart brands like Odor Ono leverage outside experts. Trigger number six, mystery. Well, I can take this off. Feels nice, though. Who knows what movie that's from? What movie is that? What? What?
Cloverfield.
Thank you. Someone got it. You get bonus points. I don't know what I'm going to give you. Maybe like a, I wish I had like brought muffins or something. That sounds delicious, doesn't it? Cloverfield. So when they did the first ad, the first trailer for Cloverfield, and I didn't have enough time to like play a 3-minute trailer for you, it's all an entire mystery. There's no branding of Cloverfield of any kind on the first trailers. It just shows kids at a party and then a giant roar and then the head of the Statue of Liberty in their front yard. And that campaign worked really well. And J.J. Abrams, you know, the director of Cloverfield, Lost, the new Star Wars movie, is fantastic at the mystery trigger, at creating mysteries, both in his campaigns and in terms of getting people to come back for television shows and for things like Lost. And that's why people come back. And there's two reasons why mysteries capture attention scientifically. The first is actually something called the Zignarik effect. So in the 1950s, there was this woman, Bluma Zignarik. She was a researcher, a Soviet researcher. And she was sitting in a restaurant, and she noticed that these waiters that were taking her order had a perfect memory of her order until the moment they dropped it off at the kitchen, in which case they completely forgot it. And she's like, why is this? What's going on here? So what she did, kind of cruelly, was she had children create, make puzzles and finish puzzles. But in half the case studies, she took their puzzles away at the halfway point. Guess which ones? Guess which puzzles and tasks the kids remembered 3 or 4 months out? The ones they didn't have a chance to complete. We have a greater memory for incomplete tasks and incomplete stories and incomplete thoughts. Again, the Zignarik effect. Another reason why mysteries capture attention, oh, that's a great, is because of something called uncertainty reduction principle. So we're going to do this date example again. So you seem like you'd be great on a date. He's like, no, I wouldn't. you see, I would say that. If we're on a date interaction, what are we going to do? We're going to start asking small talk questions. Where are you from? That kind of thing. What do you like? What do you not like? And the reason why is because we need to figure out whether or not we want to be around this person or that sort of thing, whether or not they're a person that we want to hang out with or date or et cetera. And the reason we do this is because we dislike uncertainty. And uncertainty reduction theory is a communications theory that states that we have these kind of interactions with strangers because we don't want to have the uncertainty in any kind of relationship, in anything. And so the more information we gain, the less uncertainty we have about the strangers around us. And this is what we do in relationships and on dates, and it's the same thing that we do with mysteries. The uncertainty of a mystery makes us, compels us to pay more attention because we need to know how something ends. It kills us when we're at that cliffhanger and we can't know what's going to happen next. It's part of the reason why the Malaysian Airlines disaster captured so much attention. It's not the fact that a plane crashed. It happens all the time. It's the fact that no one knows where the plane went. And suddenly you had massive amounts of speculation in CNN and every other news network because we, in our attempt to fill to complete that uncertainty gap, fill it in with speculation and fill it in with our own theories because we do not like uncertainty. We do not like unsolved mysteries. And so capturing attention really comes down to the creating that mystery and creating suspense. And in fact, it's not just about storytelling, but it's also things like advertising. This is my favorite ad from this year's Super Bowl. It's different than, say, the Nationwide ad, which my only association with them is Nationwide kills kids. I know no one works at Nationwide here. Someday I'm going to do a presentation, and someone's going to be from Nationwide, and it's going to be awkward. But this is the Budweiser commercial, and what they did was, you know, they had the puppy, and the puppy's trying to, like, get back home, and you know they're not, Budweiser's not going to kill the puppy. They're not Nationwide. But there's that moment-to-moment suspense of what's going to happen to the puppy. How is the puppy going to escape the wolves? How's the puppy going to get back home? And there was a study that found that actually the more moment-to-moment suspense an ad has, the more positivity and the more remembering people have of that ad. And so that's one of the reasons why this ad was one of the top ones of the Super Bowl, because moment-to-moment suspense really creates pleasure and really creates interest and captivation. It's also about using cliffhangers and getting people to come back to the table by having something, a mystery that can't complete until they come back. Unless, of course, you're going through a press crisis. So, you know, we know that guy. He put out a half-assed statement that was complete bullshit. I'm sorry, that's what it was. And what happened was that it didn't complete the mystery loop. There was still speculation of what really happened. Are you really sorry? What's going to happen next? And when you have that, again, people fill it in with speculation. It's the same thing that happened with Justine Sacco. If you remember last year when she tweeted that AIDS joke and she hopped on a plane and 10 hours later, she was the number one trending topic on Twitter because she didn't have a chance to respond and close the mystery gap. And in fact, actually, at the same time, Steve Martin had a really, really offensive tweet, but nothing happened to him because he was able to delete his tweet and apologize within about 3 minutes. She had 10 hours to let this fester. But it's the difference between Brian Williams with his half-assed statement and Bill O'Reilly, who we do have a different frame of reference for, but went very much very clear, like, this did not happen, here's how it happened, and went straight for that, and completing the mystery loop and making it so that the mystery died down. I also think about Airbnb. I don't know if you remember a few years ago, but Airbnb had a crisis. They had a gal named EJ, and she rented out her place, and she came to it completely ransacked and destroyed by the renters. And the Airbnb didn't do a good job of managing it. You know, they let it fester, so she made a blog post about it, and that went viral. And then here was the CEO's response on Hacker News. Basically, lawyer shit, lawyer speak. It was like, no apology, being like, we hold our community at the highest standard. This does not complete the mystery gap. This does not complete the gap of uncertainty. It just kept on filling the speculation of how is she going to respond, what's going to happen next. Eventually, they got the picture after the controversy blew up even more, and they put out this apology in a blog post, and being like, we effed up. We are very sorry. Here's how we're going to fix it. And suddenly, the story was done because they completed the mystery gap loop, because they ended the mystery. And when you're trying to end a press crisis, you end the mystery by giving all the information and not giving any more chance for speculation. Final trigger, and then think about your questions, whatever you want to ask. and you're all a very lovely audience. Except one or two of you, I see you sleeping, but you know, I forgive you. Acknowledgement. So, I found one fascinating study during my research, and what they did, kind of cruelly as well, researchers are cruel sometimes, some of you are very cruel, is they strapped electrodes to the ankles of married women. And yeah, exactly. Nothing that's going to kill them, I hope at least. But they had three different conditions. First condition was strapped with electrodes with nobody next to them. Second condition was they got a stranger to hold their hand. And the third condition was they got their husband to hold their hand. Now, the ones who felt the most pain were the ones who had no one to hold the hand of. And the ones who felt the least pain, as you would imagine, are the ones that were able to hold their husband's hands. They were able to transfer their attention away from pain and towards their husbands. But even more interesting, there was a direct correlation between the strength of their marriages and the amount of pain they felt. The stronger their marriages, the less pain they felt. And that is kind of symbolizes to me the power of acknowledgement. And it is that we pay attention to those who pay attention to us and provide us with validation, empathy, acknowledgement, and understanding. And so, in this quest to understand this a little bit more, I interviewed, and this is from the actual interview, Adrian Grenier from the show Entourage and Dr. Thomas Dason Gotita. People may not know this, but a couple years ago, they teamed up for a documentary called Teenage Paparazzo. And it's this, you know, it's this, they followed a teenage paparazzi and his work and how celebrity culture and why we're obsessed with celebrities. And so they had this interesting fascination with it. And the three of us concluded in this interview that a lot of it is actually the reason we pay attention to celebrities is not just because they're figures that we know, but it's because they're reflections of ourselves in a way. They provide us with an identity. And so think about it. Saying that you're a fan of One Direction or Justin Bieber or Sheryl Sandberg or Microsoft says something about you, who you are, the community you belong to. And there are kids who know their favorite celebrities or their favorite YouTube stars more than their own parents. In fact, I had a friend, one of my old colleagues, tell me, she works for Rachel Ray, and she was telling me that when Rachel Ray came out in support of Obamacare, her audience was crushed. They were like, I thought I knew you, you've betrayed me. And it's insane, they don't know this person. But it actually makes sense. It's something called the parasocial relationship. And so with the parasocial relationship, it is our capability to have a two-way relationship. It is our ability to have a two-way relationship with a person, even though it's only a one-way relationship, in the sense that we feel like we know a Jennifer Lawrence, but she's never going to actually know us. She's never going to actually ever meet us, but we feel a direct connection. And that's what the greatest brands and the greatest celebrities do. It's the reason why a company like Microsoft is around for 40 years instead of three. It's the reason why a Beyonce can drop an album and make it a bestseller and millions of others can't. And so Taylor Swift, for example, builds a parasocial relationship with her audience by, like, this is what she did last Christmas, which was she wrapped gifts on YouTube and she sent them to random fans that she like was following online. And this was a sensation. She didn't have to actually give a gift to every single one of her fans to acknowledge them. Just the mere action of giving a gift to one of her fans made it feel like as if she gave a gift to all of her fans. And she was able to build this parasocial relationship with her entire audience. I call this scaling the unscalable because she's able to scale personal relationships in a way that wouldn't normally be possible. And so the key to acknowledgement, the key to attention, and the most powerful type of attention is to find ways to validate your audience. Part of the reason, for example, why Facebook and Twitter and other social networks are so powerful on our attention is because they give us constant validation in the form of likes, comments, retweets, and that sort of thing. I call it the validation society. By being able, like, you think about how can I post the best status update and get that little bit of high, that opioid high, that dopamine loop kicks in again. Because we're looking for constant validation of our identity or sort of thing. One actually interesting thing I also learned, I interviewed Jonah Peretti, the CEO of BuzzFeed, is that a lot of their articles are written for validation. One of the articles that they wrote, for example, is one like 54 things Minnesotans are too humble to brag about. And when they put that article out, guess what? All of Minnesota lit up like a beacon sharing. Why? Because it was a positive validation of an identity. It was, it's good to be a Minnesotan, and I'm proud to be a Minnesotan. And they, that spread like wildfire. And if you look through BuzzFeed's articles, you have tons of that in their quizzes and everything else. Whether you're a 90s kid, or you're from a Chicago, or whether, you know, you come from a cold state, or whatever it might be. They find ways to constantly and positively validate their audience. There's another way to validate your audience, and I'm going to talk about it here. And some of you may know this story, but in the 1950s, Betty Crocker and Duncan Hines and all the others were trying to sell cake mix. Bisquick was popular, but cake mix had not taken off. And they were having a real struggle figuring out why was cake mix failing. And so they turned to two researchers for help on this. And what they found the answer was, is eggs. So in the old version of the 1950s, they had powdered eggs. You honestly don't actually need fresh eggs to have the same kind of taste with cake mixes or Bisquick mixes or any kind of mixes. But what happened was that when it was all you had to do was add milk, nobody felt like they had any kind of input into the recipe, into anything else. And what the research said was allow people to put the eggs in on their own, and they will feel more connected to the product. And so that's what they did, and they advertised that fact. And after a year, Betty Crocker suddenly won the whole game because they enabled participation. Enabling participation is another way for validation and the validation effect. It's the reason why, for example, Kickstarter is, you know, in one of the most popular platforms around, because it's not just buying a product, it's you being participating in the creation of something. It's you being at a deeper involvement. Vitamin Water a few years ago asked their audience, you know, to help them create a new flavor. They trusted them enough to have the input, and that was a viral sensation for them. Eventually they created Connect as their drink, and it really helped Vitamin Water sales because they were providing that validation and that participation. And so I've talked to you about the 7 key captivation triggers: automaticity, framing, disruption, reward, reputation, mystery, and acknowledgement. And you kind of tell that they go across all 3 stages. Automaticity is really a powerful tool for immediate attention, while disruption is a great tool for short attention. But mysteries and acknowledgement are great for long attention. And it's this kind of process of walking your audience step by step through the 3 stages of attention that really matters when it comes to capturing attention. And so if you want to contact me, because I literally run a business card, because South by Southwest is brutal to everything in your entire body, I'm still somehow standing. You can email me, or you can send a tweet, or you can check out the book, which, of course, you know, there's the book right there, which is amazing. But I'm now here to answer your questions. Thank you very much. All right, question time. When I ask, I want to know your name and what you do.
I'm Matt Jackson. I'm a senior technical account manager.
Hi, Matt.
Hi. Kind of 2 things really quick. So you talked about people having different associations with different things, and oftentimes that can be based on their country or their culture. So when you're looking at, as an individual, presenting to people across cultural and international boundaries, what are some guiding lights, or what are some resources that we could look to try and appeal to the greatest number?
I actually list one I list a few in the book, because I had that very thought in my head. And so there's a couple. I can even send it to you, but it's also in the book. There was this one firm that made a great kind of color wheel showing the associations that different countries have and different cultures have with different colors and different cultures. And there's a couple sites that are in the book, and I can send you some. But there's a whole bunch of research that's been done in this area, especially for colors. In the end, it's just knowing your audience. It's being on the ground and being able to say, having people there and being like, how will people react to this? What are the automatic reactions people have to that? What are the associations people have with this color, with this sound, with this sensory input? And that's the first thing. It's just doing the research. It's going on the ground and actually having people who are from that culture and finding that answer.
Okay. And then can I do a quick follow-up? You said that orange and yellow were most associated with incompetence. So I have to ask, what do you think of the Microsoft logo?
Well, the Microsoft logo has multiple colors, so that is not an issue for them, you know. Let's see. You got red, you got blue, you got both competence and not competence. Honestly, the stronger thing is about the long-term associations people make. You know, McDonald's yellow, you know, whether you think they're incompetent or not. Actually, that probably makes sense for McDonald's. But the symbol has become so powerful, this associations, that just merely viewing the symbol, the research shows, makes people more hungry. And that's exactly what they want to do. It's the associations are also built over time based on, you know, culture and based on what you do and what you represent, you know? And, you know, the Microsoft logo will have different associations for different people. I know that nowadays you're really trying to push the productivity message, but I'm sure that some people will have a more negative message, which is part of why, for example, it's probably a great idea to go Spartan instead of IE, because IE's associations are in the shitter. It's the same thing like when they took over, when Justin Timberlake and friends took over MySpace, I was like, you are all idiots. Because the associations with MySpace were already done for. Nobody's gonna go fucking back to MySpace, no matter how good you look at it. Make a whole brand new site. They would have done much better. All right, questions. Awesome, thank you for your questions, by the way. What's your name?
Matt Jackson.
No, behind you.
Behind you, sorry.
Sorry, you're not the center of my world anymore.
I was hoping we'd go on a date.
I'm sorry.
So Mark Agar, I work on trying to improve the efficiency of our data centers. You talked about incentives and rewards, mm-hmm. and you know how surprise rewards are more powerful than upfront incentives. Can you elaborate a little bit on sort of how much of a surprise it needs to be? How do you get people to actually do anything in the first place?
So there's two things I think about. There are six types of rewards. There's collections. There's gifting, for example, in social games. You think about how you could give your friend an extra life. But it's actually not you giving an actual gift. It's from the game. It's just in the form of gifting. But gifting is actually a much more powerful form of giving a reward than straight incentives. And so, yes, sometimes you need to use incentives to get things started. But people will go through kind of the behavior loop. And one book I also recommend, beyond my book, of course, is Nirial's book, Hooked, which talks about how you build habit-forming products and how certain rewards you reach that next level, and what you're doing is you walk them through the steps of what you want them to do the first time, and you reinforce the behavior by the rewards after the fact. There are some times where incentives are necessary, but more often than not, they're not actually, it's not as necessary as just have a simple way to walk through a product. One of the main issues people have tons of products with how they design products is that there are multiple paths people can take, and that's not actually a good thing in typical cases. It's much easier to walk people through one path and reward them for walking through that path and going through the cycle that you want them to go through. All right, who has questions? All right, awesome. What's your name?
My name is Dom Surfer. I tweeted you this morning.
Yay, she tweeted you this morning. I remember your tweet.
I'm a program manager in Windows. Mm-hmm. My question has nothing to do with work, but what does Beyonce do that's different than Lady Gaga?
So Beyonce and Lady Gaga both do a great job. It's just Beyonce's branding's a little bit better. And so the thing with Lady Gaga is she relied too much on the disruption trigger. She relied too much on meat dresses all the time. And you can actually see the branding change with her recently and how, you know, like in the Grammys and that, and not the Grammys, the Oscars, she's going less away from that and doing more the long attention sort of thing. Like, Lady Gaga was at her best when she was focusing on the little monsters and talking to them about how you were born this way. That was probably her most powerful song because it was a validation of a huge audience of hers. Beyonce has done for years this audience kind of building, longer than Lady Gaga has with the Beehive, and really, really validating them. When you think about things like how she'd like go to like a Walmart. And she did right after the album came out. And she bought everyone's stuff, everyone in the store, like $70,000 worth of stuff just because she was there. And that kind of thing spreads like wildfire. And she's cultivated this very, very kind of strong image. There's the associations you automatically have with her. She no longer has to rely on short attention techniques like disruption to capture attention. She relies on the audience she's built in long attention. She doesn't have to go to people. People come to her. Let's do a few more questions, and I know we're going to do signing, and you can always ask me any other questions you have with the book or anything else. Hello.
Mike Lee, operations engineer in Xbox.
Hi.
Hi. You mentioned when you started that you were going to talk about ways to keep people from capturing your attention. grabbing your attention.
So defending your attention.
Defending your attention.
That's what I call it.
Yeah.
So my biggest thesis in the whole thing is that when you understand how attention works, it helps you defend your attention. By knowing some of these techniques and why they work and the science behind why our brains, for example, are so addicted to experts, you are much better able to defend your attention and realize, you know, I'm paying too much attention to this because they had an expert say it was okay. And sometimes, you know, it can be a good thing because, you know, if a doctor tells me I need to take medication, I probably should. They know more than me. Or take a vaccine. But on the other hand, you know, there's a lot of, you know, false experts and others that do hurt our attention and have steered us the wrong way. And knowing just the mere fact that there's a science behind why we pay attention to experts makes you more able to defend your attention. In my estimation, it's really about the knowledge helps you defend your attention because you're able to see, and at least this is how it's been for me, I'm able to see why lots of certain things capture my attention over others and utilize that knowledge to know whether or not I want to pay attention. I think what you'll see over the next 5, 10, 15 years is us continuing to adapt to this rapidly changing world of constant information and better managing our attention as a result. Because right now, we're in this kind of transitionary period. But I think with more knowledge, and especially the scientific knowledge, we'll be better at controlling our attention. One other thing I discuss, for example, in the book is why smartphone notifications capture our attention. And it's the same reason, again, why hunter-gatherers, our attention has not really changed that much. Our attention kept on shifting constantly with hunter-gatherers because we had to detect threats or detect food. But we don't have that issue anymore, right? So that loop has been replaced literally by smartphone notifications because our short attention is attracted to novelty. And so even just knowing that knowledge helps you think, you know what, I need to turn off the notifications because they're designed to capture your attention because that's how we were built. And so you want to concentrate, turn off the goddamn notifications. Let's see, maybe one or two more and then signing. Do we have any other questions? You've been awesome, by the way. Thank you so much. All right. I think that was a good time. So I will be here for a little bit, signing, chatting, maybe dancing if like other things happen, eating at some point, because apparently you need to do that to survive. But thank you so much for being an amazing audience, and I'd love to hear more from you.